part of the Arbitration Day Organization Committee, and I'm just here to introduce our commercial arbitration panel. So in line with the theme today, which was Winds of Change, our commercial arbitration panel will discuss commercial arbitration, where is it headed? And we're very fortunate to have Professor Loukas Mistelis here to moderate our panel. Professor Mistelis is professor at the Queen Mary University of London. He is a member of the Center for Commercial Law Studies and the director of the School of International Arbitration. Professor Mistelis, I'm leaving the floor to you. Thank you, everyone.
So, good morning, everyone. It's admirable that people would come on a Saturday to hear about arbitration, but perhaps that's quite about where the field is moving. Just as I was arriving today, I had a short chat with Richard Feldman, who has addressed you earlier this morning, and who is somebody I've known from perhaps the last 25, if not probably longer than that, years. And the very title of the Cambridge Arbitration Day today, the Winds of Change, reminded very very much of a song by Scorpions. If you remember that song, you would remember that it goes back to the 1980s when there were winds of change and winds of change around Europe. With sort of the collapse of the Soviet Union. That perhaps was something arguably positive that comes up, something from arguably negative, I'm using the terms loosely here. And the question is whether we have a situation where we have something positive coming out of something negative or something negative coming out of something positive. And a lot of discussion has been had in the last sort of 5 years about the golden era of arbitration, and perhaps in this period of alternative facts and fake news, it is my proposition that we are perhaps in the post-golden era of arbitration, if the golden era perhaps was highlighted best by the New York Convention and creating a regime which was entirely facilitative and fairly uncomplicated in terms of regulation. So my panel, which to some extent resembles an IBA panel with hot topics, so more than one, is a smorgasbord where you're going to find some venison, some reindeer, perhaps even some herring. I'm not going to say what is what, but that perhaps will emerge in the discussion, and you like, don't like wrong options. But I have four excellent speakers for you to address the topics in the order of the discussion of the program. What I'm proposing to do, I will introduce them very, very briefly. Then each of them will introduce the topic. And once we have all the topics introduced, then we have a discussion for all topics together. That's perhaps the fairest way to sort of give all of them more or less equal sort of airtime. And I'm not going to be interfering in the session with tweets or any other Instagram sort of comments. I would leave that to the discussion as it ought to be. The person who will go first, Duncan Speller, is an English barrister with now a partner with WilmerHale, and has a wealth of experience in litigation and arbitration. One of the very interesting things that comes to his CV is that he speaks Japanese. Konnichiwa. So he will be, but he will not address us in Japanese, don't worry, but he will address us on the nebulous topic, and indeed nebulous is the word of the ethics of counsel in the national arbitration and the need for regulation and represents the different views. The second person to go is Richard Smith, further to my right, not ideologically, I think, who's addressing the question of due process and how it's not being used more as a sword rather than a shield. I think we might have to take some responsibility for this topic. We have coined the phrase due process paranoia, and it's been taken through our 2015 survey, and it's been taken by a number of speeches by UCB, and many others. So Richard, who has also a number of insurance disputes experience, and does not speak Japanese as far as I can tell, or any of the others of those specific languages, he stays to the court in English, will address the topic. The third person to address you is going to be speaking about third parties. And that is Marco de Souza, a lawyer with Herbert Smith Frickhills. I do not perhaps say that Richard is without a lawyer, I should say that. So Marco is with Herbert Smith Frickhills and has practiced in various offices of the firm, including Dubai and Hong Kong. And he's actually on a Cambridge graduate, so he's kind of come to address you on this particular topic. Again, third parties is a topic that is been discussed quite a bit, but there's always new issues coming up in many jurisdictions, including in this home jurisdiction of ours here. So last, not least, Roland Ziadeh from Linklaters of the last 3 years, but also a number of very prominent terms before. He will be addressing the innovations that have come through the emergence of expedited procedures. That's something that has been, again, coming up a discussion that arbitration perhaps being tailor-made for medium-sized disputes, not being very good in smaller cases, perhaps not being very good in bigger cases, but simpler cases. So he will address how arbitration institutions and arbitration tribunals respond to that question. And again, somebody with a lot of experience and a member of the ICC court will give us quite a bit of insight. So I will give the floor, it will go also from speaker to speaker, and we'll come back for the discussion. So, Duncan, you're on.
Good morning, everyone. It's a pleasure to be here. Thanks very much to the organizers for organizing such an interesting theme, the winds of change. I'm going to address the topic of the ethics of international arbitration and whether there's a need for regulation. Implicit in that question is an assumption that there's not regulation at the moment. And on that view, opinions within the international arbitration community differ widely. On the one hand, you have people like Catherine Rogers, who described arbitration as ethical no man's land. On the other hand, Gary Bourne has likened the profusion of regulation in arbitration to a teenager's bedroom, which connotes all sorts of disorder or a Rubik's cube of different ethical regulations. So I'm going to tackle question briefly in four stages. Firstly, why are we concerned about this issue? Why do ethics matter in international arbitration? Secondly, what tools do we already have? Thirdly, what new tools could be used? What are the options in terms of future directions that international arbitration could take? And fourthly, what is the way forward? And my conclusion will be that tribunals already have the tools we need to ensure that international arbitration is conducted ethically and fairly, and that the future lies in not in creating new tools, but already using the tools we already have. And I'm going to conclude by introducing briefly five guidelines that might assist tribunals and parties to use the procedures that are already there to ensure that arbitration is conducted as ethically and fairly as possible. So firstly, why are we concerned about ethics? Well, arbitration is a rules-based process, and therefore people should play by the rules. Secondly, there's an importance to consistency and transparency. And ethics are about ensuring that there is a level playing field in international arbitration. And there is an importance in preserving the integrity of the process and preserving respect for the process in ensuring that we're not playing on a field like that, but rather on a level playing field. And this issue comes up in practice in a number of areas where there are potentially quite different views as to what is ethical practice. One area that comes up a lot is witness preparation. In some jurisdictions, including the United States, it's commonplace to prepare witnesses, including by conducting mock cross-examination. Under the English Bar Council rules, it's prohibited to conduct a mock cross-examination on the basis that that is leading the witness to prepare their answers and depart from what may be truthful testimony. There are also broad differences in terms of disclosure and an obligation to produce documents. Many English lawyers will be used to the notion that they have an ethical obligation to provide material documents to the court or the decision maker. Conversely, civil lawyers may consider that they have a duty not to turn over unlawful documents. So there are two quite different standards there. Standards also differ, for example, on whether there should be ex parte communications to the tribunal. In many jurisdictions, the notion that there should be ex parte communications is frowned upon. In China and some jurisdictions where it's expected that arbitrators play a more active role in promoting settlement, ex parte communications are more commonplace. So what tools do we already have? On the one hand, there's a lack of an overarching set of ethical guidelines. The European Council of Bar Organizations has produced a code of conduct, but it's fairly circular. And it says that the lawyer must comply with the rules of conduct of the court or tribunal they appear before, which essentially directs you back to a separate set of rules. But on the other hand, and this links to my key theme, the tribunal, under most sets of institutional rules, has a very broad discretion to adopt procedures to suit the particular circumstances of the case. And that is one of the great benefits of arbitration, that there's not a rigid set of rules, that arbitrators have the discretion and the flexibility to adopt a set of rules that is most suited to the particular case. The LCIA rules, for example, refer to the tribunal having the widest discretion to adopt procedures suitable to the circumstances of the arbitration. And the tribunal can back that up with sanctions, that the tribunal can take into account the party's conduct in the award of costs. We see similar provisions under the ICC rules. Ethics has been a hot topic in international arbitration, and new tools have emerged. In 2013, the International Bar Association published guidelines on party representation that address many of the sorts of ethical dilemmas we touched on before, such as whether there should be ex parte communications, the duty of counsel with respect to the preparation of witness testimony. These guidelines are not intended to replace national ethical guidelines, but rather to supplement them, and the parties can either opt into them by agreement or the tribunal can incorporate them by reference. The LCIA rules have recently been amended to introduce at Annex 1 a set of ethical guidelines that apply in LCIA arbitration. So these guidelines, again, address issues such as the duty of counsel with respect to disclosure, to not deliberately misleading the tribunal, and ex parte communications. And again, they don't replace national ethical standards, but are intended to supplement them. And the ICC, just this year, has produced a note to parties and tribunals, which again addresses the expectation that tribunals, that the parties and their counsel will abide by the higher standards of integrity. So we already have a broad armory of tools to ensure ethical conduct in international arbitration, but what other options are there? And a number of options have been raised by different people. Elliot Geisinger, the president of the Swiss Arbitration Association, has proposed a global ethics council that would consist of members of different arbitral bodies, and there would be an overarching bar regulatory body to which arbitration council would subscribe. That is one way of kind of having a supranational regulatory body. There seems to be limited appetite for that at this stage. Another option would be that arbitral institutions adopt codes of conduct. And to some extent, the LCIA has done that with the annex included in the LCIA arbitration rules. But the risk in that is of fragmentation and of different standards being applied by different arbitral institutions. A third option would be to have codes of conduct as part of national law at the seat. And this has been proposed by Jane Wessel and others. But that is a national solution to an international problem and creates a risk, again, of different standards and therefore a lack of uniformity. So in conclusion, what is the way forward? I think the way forward is more proactive use of the tools that tribunals already have. Tribunals already have the discretion and the power to adopt procedures suitable to the case. That can include addressing ethical issues, such as to what extent it's appropriate for counsel to be engaged in witness preparation, such as the duties of parties and counsel with respect to disclosure, such as whether it's ever appropriate to have ex parte communications. All these are issues that tribunals can address transparently as part of their procedural orders, and as to which tribunals already have the power and ability to put in place clear guidelines. And I think in the application of the tools we already have, perhaps five guidelines are useful for tribunals and counsel to bear in mind. I think the first guideline is that all this debate about ethics is very useful in that it ensures tribunals are conscious of these issues and address them. Secondly, tribunals should seek to level the playing field. Where there are potential differences in approach between counsel, tribunals should be sensitive to that and potentially give clear rules that level the playing field. Thirdly, there should be transparency. And I think tribunals can address these issues transparently as part of a procedural order. Fourthly and fundamentally, no counsel should be compelled to do anything that is contrary to the ethical rules that apply to them. But fifthly, in the interest of ensuring a level playing field, tribunals can supplement those duties and impose additional duties that do help level the playing field. So, to conclude, before we think about giving the teenager new toys, let's tidy the bedroom. One of the great things about tidying the bedroom is that you find things you never realized you had. Maybe now is the chance for us to find the powers that the tribunal has to address these issues. Thank you very much.
Good morning, ladies and gentlemen. I can confirm I don't speak Japanese, nor do I have proficiency in PowerPoint, so I've just got my voice. The subject I'm introducing this morning, and which will hopefully lead to some debate shortly, is the increasing use of due process as a sword, not a shield. Now, when swords and shields are mentioned, many people might think perhaps of Game of Thrones. I haven't seen it, and that's why I wasn't invited to the event yesterday, but I'm told it's very gripping. For the English lawyers in the room, swords and shields might lead them to think about contract law and the principles of estoppel. To English lawyers like me who practice insurance, I must confess a thought or two towards common interest privilege. Were Donald Trump in the room, I think he might tweet sad. But a sword might not be thought to conjure up associations with due process, unless perhaps you've just been charged with possession of an offensive weapon. However, there is a discernible trend in commercial arbitration, anecdotal perhaps, but reported increasingly, parties are invoking due process complaints to press arbitral tribunals to make procedural decisions in their favour. It could be that party A needs more time to file her pre-hearing brief, and that puts the hearing at jeopardy. Party B may want to amend its case very late in the day to add a cause of action, or party C may want to lob in a witness statement at the 11th hour, addressing facts which their opponents haven't had an opportunity to consider. Now, there's nothing particularly new in any of these procedural shenanigans, save perhaps an increasingly insidious undercurrent flowing beneath the requests for the tribunal's indulgence and the responses from the other party to those requests. Parties A, B, and C will say that unless they're allowed to do what they want and what they've asked of the tribunal, their due process rights will have been curtailed. That complaint is often accompanied by a reservation of rights. The other party may say that due process rights of his own will be infringed if the tribunal goes along with those requests. And the unsubtle subtext to all of this is that if you don't give me what I want, I will challenge the tribunal for any award it might ultimately render on due process grounds. So, like the child craving sweets, make as much noise as you can and maybe you'll get, procedurally at least, what you demand. And even if individually, a single complaint might not invoke due process complaints, accumulating enough examples might just, it is thought, tip the balance. Well, how real is that threat? Or in Game of Thrones parlance, should arbitral tribunals feel under siege? In my view, they shouldn't. For most procedural decisions, so long as the parties have been allowed to express their view as to which way the tribunal should jump, the norms of due process will rarely ever be engaged, let alone curtailed. And that's because due process is concerned with overarching basic principles of fairness. It doesn't provide guidelines for the exercise of a tribunal's procedural discretion. First, the tribunals must be given notice of the case being advanced against them, but that's usually achieved fairly simply through a notice of arbitration and the submissions which follow. Secondly, parties are entitled to equal treatment, but unequal treatment doesn't follow just because of an adverse procedural decision. Nor, indeed, without more, can such decision be said to render a tribunal partial. Fourth, and this is perhaps the limb where you see most due process complaints being invoked in a procedural context, tribunals are required to allow parties a fair opportunity to present their case and to respond to that of the other party, including at a hearing if the parties want one. And as I say, that's perhaps the most overused or cliched basis for due process complaints. But the right to a fair opportunity to present a case does not allow a party to dictate the manner in which that is to be achieved or prevent the party from deciding to steer its own procedural course. Forgive me for being a little parochial for one moment, but if you look at what the English 1996 Arbitration Act says, the tribunal's general duty is to provide a reasonable opportunity for putting their case. And that's mirrored the reasonable language in the instant trial of the ICC, the LCA, and a number of other rules. And giving that part, the parties that reasonable opportunity, the tribunal is also required, as part of its general duty, to have regard to considerations of cost and delay, so procedural efficiency factors and all that as well. And the tribunal has a broad range of powers, and under the relevant institutional rules, or the unsatural rules, for example, it has considerable discretion as to how those powers are to be exercised. And then if you take it a step further, when it comes to the limited circumstances in which, again, I'll be a little parochial, the English courts will review arbitration awards on grounds of serious procedural irregularity, and how narrowly the courts approach such challenges, a tribunal's unlikely to be criticised for making a procedural decision which falls within its power. And likewise, challenges to enforcement under the New York Convention are similarly difficult, because the due process issues there with which the courts enforcing awards are concerned is whether the parties have notice of proceedings and whether they were able to present their case. The convention is not concerned with the usual procedural skirmishes that you see in arbitration. So that's not to say that procedural decisions never engage considerations of due process. So for example, an expedited procedural timetable in arbitration is one thing, and many is the time I've had a judge or an arbitrator say to me, "But surely, Mr. Smith, with the ample resources of Allen and Overy, before telling me I can do what he's asking me to do in a week." That's one thing. But in certain circumstances, imposing a timetable which is simply impossible, and I've seen it, impossible for parties to comply with, could engage due process requirements. And perhaps more obviously, where a tribunal doesn't give notice of a hearing to one of the parties or proceeds with a hearing when a witness has a genuine inability to attend and doesn't have an opportunity to put its case. And more obviously still, where an arbitrator makes comments which suggest that he or she is biased against one of the parties. But those are rare events and perhaps not really concerned with the usual to-ings and fro-ings where some parties are ascribing more significance from a due process perspective than is warranted. So if, in a sense, there's not much to the point, why then is there an increasing threat of swords clashing? Or put more bluntly, who's to blame? Well, if a blame game is to be played, yes, there are some unnecessarily aggressive parties who at any opportunity will pray in aid of due process to make a procedural complaint. Sometimes you will find a genuine clash of different cultural expectations as to the significance of matters procedural. And on occasion, you do find tribunals which frankly could afford to be more forceful or robust in their approach. However, to my mind, the problem is more deep-rooted than the idiosyncrasies of the parties involved and the players involved. In my view, the commoditization of arbitration has given parties a greater sense of entitlement when it comes to procedural matters. Now, what do I mean by that? Well, although each arbitration is unique, a practice has grown up by which most cases follow a fairly standard pattern. There will often be a case management conference at the start of a case, usually preceded, though, by the circulation of a procedural order containing standard steps with which, frankly, the parties often agree, and which the tribunals are often willing to endorse. So at the early stage of the process, there may be very little scrutiny by the parties in the tribunal of what procedural steps are actually required for this case, as opposed to what's gone before in other cases and with which everyone feels generally comfortable. Those steps include the service of a memorial, often by the claimant, followed by a responsive counter-memorial from the respondent, setting out in elaborate detail the legal and factual arguments relied on by the parties, accompanied by all the evidence, the authorities, and exhibiting voluminous documentation. And these memorials are often fairly impenetrable documents themselves, running to hundreds of pages, which sometimes you wonder if tribunals ever actually read. Then you have disclosure, usually under the IPA rules, often without consideration as to whether you actually need disclosure at all in this case, or if you do, in what areas you need it. And frankly, I've never found a smoking document in a smoking gun document in a case. And the usefulness of disclosure, from my perspective, tends to be filling the gaps that the experts need in cases to crystallise their thinking. However, by the disclosure stage, we've already had one round of expensive experts' reports, sometimes incomplete. And then following disclosure, we have another round of memorials, a reply and a rejoinder, often equally long and impenetrable as the first round, but perhaps expert aspects apart, not really taking the case that much further. And then both parties before the hearing may have a chance to serve a pre-hearing brief, perhaps equally lengthy, and at least if you've only recently served your rejoinder, again, not adding much to what's gone before. Then you have the hearing, which, depending upon the issues in play, can actually be relatively short, which forces the parties to compress their oral submissions and their witness examination into a limited period, and I think that elevates the significance of those written submissions which have gone before, trying to ensure that you at least make your points, which you can't make at the hearing, somewhere. And you may have oral closings, followed or preceded by written post-hearing briefs, providing another lengthy and expensive opportunity to regurgitate the case, albeit now with the benefit of the oral evidence that has been recently heard. Sometimes you can have reply post-hearing briefs, and you may have separate cost submissions and reply cost submissions. And finally, once the tribunal has waded through all that material and the transcripts, you may get an award. What is the point I'm making in all of this? Well, in the process I've just described, I think there are far too many opportunities to present your case and to reply to that of your opponents. Against that background, parties increasingly feel they have a right to make their point repeatedly, such that any attempts by the tribunal to keep their expansive and frankly expensive memorials to the prescribed time limits or to prevent new arguments or claims being raised late in the day or stopping new evidence being thrown in are now said to represent an interference with their due process rights. And if the tribunal accedes to those manoeuvrings, the other side will make the same complaint, saying, well, hang on a minute, I'm entitled to respond to that. And they always want the last word. Although greater emphasis has been placed on case management and arbitration in recent years, including by the arbitral institutions, the focus is often on, are you going to have an early hearing? When is the award going to be rendered? I suggest it's time that parties and tribunals look more critically at pre-trial steps and rein in the number of bites of the cherry. It may not prevent these procedural skirmishes, but it may manage expectations as to what is genuinely needed to allow a party to present its case and to temper the increasing and frankly unwarranted use of due process as a sword. It might also make matters a bit cheaper. Thank you.
Good morning, everyone, and thank you for having me here today. I completed my LLM here not too long ago, so it's great to be back in Cambridge and in these lecture halls again so soon. This morning I'll be introducing the topic of third parties in commercial arbitration. And like Richard, I've spurned the traditional PowerPoint presentation, so you'll just be stuck with me for the next few minutes. Now, in a way, you might say that it's antithetical to talk about third parties in international commercial arbitration, because it's in some ways the sort of paradigm of a private consensual dispute resolution mechanism. So, of course, the jurisdiction of the tribunal is limited to the parties to the arbitration agreement. The proceedings generally take place in private, and the award only binds the parties to the proceedings. So it seems at first blush that there is very limited scope for involvement of third parties in the process. It's not like, for example, investment treaty arbitration, where there is a more obviously public element to the process. Investment treaty tribunals are, of course, routinely called on to scrutinize the exercise of public power by states, and the effect of their awards is often felt far beyond the immediate parties to the dispute. So we see more obvious, at least, third-party involvement in that sphere. and we see, of course, moves to increase the transparency of investment treaty proceedings, the use of amicus curiae, and other such mechanisms. But of course, private commercial disputes are becoming ever more complex, and commercial arbitration must adapt, must evolve to meet that complexity. In part, I think this means admitting a greater degree of third-party involvement in the process than was traditionally the case. So we've seen, of course, developments in the power of tribunals to consolidate proceedings, to join non-signatories to an arbitration agreement to the proceedings, and to exercise other case management powers to make complex multi-party and multi-contract arbitrations more efficient. But I would say this has been a gradual process of evolution. It's a case, I think, of two steps forward and one step back. So those joinder and consolidation mechanisms that are now commonplace in most institutional rules still depend to a very great degree on the consent of the parties. And of course, domestic courts are still more nimble and have greater reach when it comes to awarding interim relief, particularly against third parties. So that's very much the theme of my talk today, this idea of a gradual evolution, of two steps forward and one step back. And I should say at the outset that I think that this is no bad thing. Commercial arbitration shouldn't forget its pedigree as a private and consensual dispute resolution mechanism. Those features of the process are still some of its greatest strengths. And clients, there are features that clients actively seek out when they choose to submit their disputes to arbitration rather than sending them to the courts. And so they shouldn't be discarded as commercial arbitration evolves. Now, the issue of third parties in commercial arbitration is a multifaceted one, and I don't have the time today to cover them all. So I'm going to cover three discrete topics in sort of broad outline. I'll take first what we might call the two steps forward. I'll discuss the increasing acceptance of third-party funding in arbitration, and moves by some tribunals and courts in some jurisdictions to expand the scope of the arbitration agreement to catch non-signatories. I'll then discuss what we might perhaps unfairly call the one step back, and that's the continuing limitation of the power of tribunals to award interim relief against third parties. So taking first third party funding, I'm sure we all know what it is. It pretty much does what it says on the tin. It's essentially an arrangement where an entity that is not formally party to the proceedings covers the legal and other costs of one of the parties in exchange for an agreed return. That return usually linked to the amount of damages or a cut of the damages awarded to the funded party. And that means usually funding available only to claimants or to respondents with counterclaims. Now, financing is usually provided by, obviously, specialist third-party funders, but as the market becomes more established, other players are entering: banks, insurance companies, and in some cases even law firms. Now, for a long time, this sort of arrangement was barred under the old common law torts of champerty and maintenance. But it's now permitted in a number of jurisdictions, the US, the UK, Germany, and most recently, developments in Asia. So legislation came into force earlier this month in Singapore, permitting third-party funding in international arbitrations there. And legislation is in process in Hong Kong to do the same there. Now, there are, of course, a broad range of potential benefits to third-party funding arrangement. Perhaps most notably, it's that where a party that has a good claim but is of limited means, funding may help them to actually advance that claim. But for commercial parties, of course, it can be useful in freeing up cash that would otherwise have been devoted to funding the arbitration proceedings. It also has, I think, presentational benefits in that most funders are really quite picky about the claims that they choose to fund. It is, after all, an investment and they're expecting a return. And so funders will engage in a pretty comprehensive process of analyzing the merits of the case, often engaging external counsel to do so, and will only fund a claim that they think has a good prospect of success. So the presence of a funder can act as something of a vote of confidence for a claim and can be a factor in encouraging settlement. Now, the jurisdictions that have adopted third-party funding have, in many cases, recognized these benefits. And so the report of the Hong Kong Law Reform Commission that recommended allowing third-party funding in Hong Kong suggested that reform in this area was necessary to maintain and enhance Hong Kong's competitive position as a leading arbitral centre. But of course, third-party funding also throws up a number of potentially thorny issues in the arbitral context. Funders, of course, will want to keep a close eye on how proceedings are developing, and there will be duties of disclosure from the funded party, that may test the traditional duties of confidentiality in commercial proceedings. Conflicts of interest is another potential issue. As the market develops and becomes more mature, funders will get ever closer relationships with law firms, tribunals, and parties, and therefore become another potential source of conflict. Now, some jurisdictions and some institutional rules have addressed this concern by requiring the funded party to disclose the existence of the funding arrangement. And this certainly was the recommendation of the Law Reform Commission in Hong Kong in the legislation there. And of course, provisions put into the most recent iteration of the IBA guidelines on conflict of interest, requiring disclosure in certain circumstances. The existence of a funding relationship may also affect whether it's appropriate to award security for costs in an application, in an arbitration. The obvious argument open to a respondent, of course, is that a funded payment is an impecunious payment. Now that, of course, is not always the case, but you often see issues of disclosure of funding arrangements coming up in the context of applications for security for costs. It also raises questions about the allocation of costs in an arbitration and the recoverability of costs of funding or putting funding in place, which can be substantial. Now, for my part, I don't see that the existence of a funder should alter ultimately the tribunal's discretion to award costs in a matter, and I see no impediment to having those costs be recoverable. And I know that certain tribunals have taken that view, and those costs orders have been, or awards have been upheld by the English courts. There's a question there as well, of course, about whether tribunals should be able to make orders for security for costs against the funder themselves, or order the funder to pay costs where the funded party is unsuccessful. And the argument running that an unsuccessful funded party, the funder should put up those costs to avoid a proliferation of claims. Of course, in practice, this is usually dealt with in the funding agreement. Now, despite these thorny issues, I think it's fair to say that third-party funding seems to be a firm fixture on the horizon of commercial arbitration, and for many reasons, a good one. My second broad topic, another recent trend, is the one of potentially expanding the scope of the arbitration agreement to cover non-signatories. Now, this can arise in sort of two broad circumstances. The first, where the additional party themselves wants to be joined to the proceedings for some reason. And the second, where that additional party resists joinder for various reasons. Now, the techniques that tribunals have available to them to address those two scenarios are quite different. But I think perhaps at the outset, I should clarify that perhaps it's disingenuous to talk about this as an issue of third parties, because in reality, the decision of courts and tribunals in this area is one of attempting simply to discern the proper scope of the consent to arbitrate. And so perhaps it's better to talk about, rather than third parties, you might say less than obvious parties. So consent remains the touchstone here, and rightly so. So the first of those scenarios where the party, the additional party, wants to be joined, of course, is now dealt with under the joining provisions that is commonplace in most institutional rules. again, of course, those provisions usually require the consent of all of the parties before a new party can join the proceedings. The LCIA rules are perhaps the outlier there in that they require only consent of the party who applies for joinder and the additional party. So you may have a situation where a tribunal joins a party over the head of objections from other parties. The trickier scenario, of course, is where the party sought to be joined resists joinder. Now, tribunals have available to them a wide spectrum of sometimes obscure legal doctrines to deal with this. Parent agency is one, piercing the corporate veil another, essentially where an entity is interposed to shield the true principal from the effect of the arbitration agreement. The group of companies doctrine is popular in civil systems, as is estoppel. Now, it's difficult to know how frequently these strategies are successful because of the paucity of reported arbitral decisions, but anecdotal evidence suggests that tribunals, rightly in my view, remain circumspect about joining non-consenting parties to the arbitration. And the risk, of course, of doing so and getting it wrong is that the courts of the seat or the place of, or place of enforcement may disagree, and the award then set aside for enforcement is refused. And the Sylvester, Lippo, and Dalla type cases are good cautionary tales for that. So, of course, I would say commercial tribunals have at their tool, at their disposal, the tools necessary to be as nimble in as domestic courts in their jurisdictional reach, but always constrained properly, I say, by this notion of consent. Now, finally, and very briefly, the one step back, if you will, and that is the limited power of tribunals to award interim relief against their parties. Now, of course, there's no question that tribunals generally can award interim relief against parties to the proceedings, and there are established powers to that effect in most institutional rules. But, of course, tribunals can't extend their reach to third parties, and this issue obviously arises where relief is sought to preserve evidence or to freeze assets that are held by a third party, usually a bank. And in those circumstances, parties must look to national courts for that sort of relief. So in England, for example, that power is given to the courts under Section 44 of the Arbitration Act. Now that limitation is, in my view, understandable and defensible. The consensual basis of arbitration must result in some limits being imposed on the reach of tribunals, and this, I think, is a coherent one. And of course, what makes, or part of what makes an arbitration, the jurisdiction arbitration friendly, although that's a terrible phrase, I think, is the existence of a reliable and efficient court system that's able to act in support of arbitration proceedings when necessary. And there's nothing especially regressive in that sort of scenario. So, to sum up, I think it's a story of gradual evolution. Consent of the parties and the limitations that that impose remains, is here to stay, I would say. But third-party involvement, I think we can say, remains firmly on the radar and an area to watch going forward. Thank you.
Good morning, ladies and gentlemen, dear friends and colleagues. The subject of expedited arbitration rules is a hot topic in light of the recent launch of the ICC expedited rule, which came into force on the 1st March of this year, i.e. less than 3 weeks ago. Why the development of expedited proceedings now? The need for expedited rules comes from the arbitral institution's firm commitment to reduce costs and promote efficiency of arbitration proceedings in light of the critics stating that arbitration has become more and more like, I would say, common law litigation with lengthy discovery proceedings and lengthy hearing process in particular. and denouncing unreasonable delays in the rendering of arbitral awards. The institution have also noticed the existence of, I would say, a relatively significant number of small claims. For instance, the ICC statistic indicated that in certain year, almost one-third of the claims submitted to the ICC were for amount equal to $2 million or less. Moreover, surveys have revealed users' demand for simplified procedures in institutional rules for smaller value claims. For instance, one of the latest Queen Mary survey revealed that 92% of respondents favor inclusion of simplified procedure in institutional rules for claim under a certain value. In light of this, most of the major arbitral institutions have implemented expedited procedures. The SCC, the SIAC, the Singapore International Arbitration Center, the Hong Kong International Arbitration Center, ICDR, CIETAC, to name a few. The ICC is the latest institution to do so. The SCC has even a separate set of arbitration rules for expedited proceedings. The expedited rules of different institutions have a number, I would say, of common features, but they also differ in certain respects, in particular as to whether they apply by default or at the option, express option, of the parties. I will explain briefly how expedited rules work and their common features among different institutions before discussing in more detail the more distinguished, potentially most controversial also, feature of the new ICC expedited rules. Expedited rules generally apply to smaller claims and provide for a tribunal composed of a sole arbitrator. Most expedited rules are applicable to disputes up to a certain specified monetary cap. For example, the expedited rules of the Hong Kong International Arbitration Center and the SIAC, Singapore International Arbitration Center, apply if the amount in dispute does not exceed respectively $3 or $4 million and if the parties so agree or in the event of emergency. The ICC expedited rules, which apply to arbitration agreement, as I mentioned, enter after the 1st March of this year, follow the majority trend as to the monetary cap, as they apply to arbitration proceeding where the amount in dispute do not exceed $2 million. However, the parties may agree to opt out of this aspect of the ICC rules in their arbitration agreement or thereafter, and even when they haven't, the ICC court may decide, in light of the circumstances of a particular dispute, once it has arisen, that such dispute is not appropriate for expedited proceedings. The revised ICC rules also permit the parties to agree to opt in to the application of the expedited rules with respect to a dispute, even if the amount in dispute is higher than the $2 million limit. The fact that the ICC is making the expedited rules available for higher value disputes shows its determination to promote greater efficiency of proceedings in general and not only and necessarily for small claims. A key feature of all major institution expedited rules is that the case is normally referred to a sole arbitrator. The ICC expedited rules provides in this regard, and I quote, the court may, notwithstanding any contrary provision of the arbitration agreement, and this is very important, appoint a sole arbitrator, end of quote. I will discuss this in more detail later on, as it is, I would say, a quite bold and controversial feature of the ICC expedited proceedings. For the arbitral procedure to in fact be expedited, the various rules provide for a number of, I would say, streamlined features. For instance, under the ICC expedited rules, no term of reference are required. Under most expedited rules, the arbitral tribunal is expressly given discretion to to decide not to allow requests for production of documents, to limit the number, length, and scope of written submissions, and to decide not to hold a hearing. This is, however, not the case, for instance, under the Swiss rule, if a party requests a hearing. All the tribunals, I submit, have generally a similar degree of discretion under the standard rule, with the exception of not holding a hearing if a party requests so. The provision of the expedited rules are intended to further encourage very active case management to ensure efficiency of the process. Most expedited rules provide that while the tribunal, the arbitral award has to be reasoned, this may be done, I would say, in a short and relative summary way. For example, the ICC note to the parties and tribunals mentioned that the tribunal in expedited proceeding may state the reason of the award in, and I quote, as concise a fashion as possible, end of quote. The SCC, expedited rules of Stockholm, go so far, so even further, as to make the requirement of a reasoned award merely optional. To streamline proceeding, expedited rules also provide for tighter time limits to render the award. There is clearly a greater expectation that the time limit will be effectively complied with and that the award will be rendered within, for instance, 6 months time frame with no need of extension under the expedited rules. The ICC expedited rule specified that the tribunal is obliged to render its award within 6 months from the case management conference, which in turn must be held within 15 days of the tribunal receiving the file. The expedited rules of some other institution calculate the time limit for rendering the award from the date of the constitution of the arbitral tribunal, with the award usually rendered within 6 months of that date. SCC award must even render within 3 months of the date when the case is referred to the sole arbitrator. The ICDR take a somewhat different approach, providing that the award in expedited proceeding must be rendered within 30 days of the closing hearing or the final written submission. The new ICC expedited rule, as other rules, nevertheless includes some safeguard to preserve the flexibility of the proceedings. Extension of time may be granted further to a reasoned request by a party or on the tribunal's own reasoned request. In addition, I know that ICC award will remain subject to the scrutiny of the ICC court, just like other ICC awards. This valuable hallmark of the ICC arbitration, which has been designed, I would say, to enforce and to strengthen and to enhance the quality and the enforceability of ICC awards, has been maintained in the process. The two most distinctive and controversial features of the ICC expedited rule are the quasi-automatic application based on the amount in dispute and the sole arbitrator provision. Let me explain. And as I've mentioned, the ICC expedited procedure applies to claims not exceeding $2 million unless the parties have opted out, for instance, in their arbitration agreement, or unless the ICC court decides otherwise. Thus, in contrast to other arbitration rules, such as SCC or SIAP, for instance, the ICC expedited rules can apply without the parties consenting to their application to a particular dispute once it has arisen. Indeed, paragraph 59 of the ICC note to the parties and arbitral tribunal confirmed that by agreeing to ICC arbitration in their arbitration agreement, the parties have agreed to the application of the expedited procedure provision of the ICC rules when applicable in precedence to any contrary term of their arbitration agreement. Unless, of course, they express opt out of the expedited rule in such an agreement or thereafter. An agreement to opt out should be clear and express in specific terms the party's intention not to subject themselves to the expedited proceedings. Some criticism has been directed at the expedited rules on the ground that even when the amount in dispute is small, some case may be sufficiently complex or important such that they would not be best or at least properly administered under the expedited proceedings, i.e. where broader interests, for instance, are at stake and which would require an oral hearing or a round of document production. The ICC expedited rules do, however, take such circumstances into account as they provide first that the court, the ICC court, may decide at any time at the request of a party or on its own motion that the expedited rules are not suitable for a particular case. For example, the court would, in all likelihood, I submit, consider that a treaty-based arbitration should not be governed by the expedited rules. And second, the wording of the rules includes some flexibility as to procedure streamlining. The arbitral tribunal has the discretion not to allow requests for document production or limit the number of written submissions, after always after consultation with the parties. So there is a dialogue at least with the parties. That said, especially where significant interest may be implicated by an arbitration, irrespective of the amount at stake, parties should, I submit, when drafting arbitration agreement providing for ICC arbitration, at least give consideration to exercise the right to opt out the expedited proceedings and the expedited rules if appropriate. Last point, perhaps the most controversial distinctive feature of the ICC expedited rules is that a sole arbitrator will normally be appointed even if the parties have provided in their arbitration agreement that disputes between them will be decided by a three-member tribunal. Some have argued that the party's right to choose a three-member tribunal is a critical part of the arbitration process, and I quote, that the right of the parties to choose a three-person panel over a sole arbitrator should not be diminished or reduced to a plain cost calculation. Others have argued that this aspect of the application of the expedited rules could, in theory, affect the enforceability of the final award under Article 5.1d of the New York Convention, which provides that the recognition and enforcement of an arbitral award may be refused if the composition of the tribunal was not in accordance with the parties' agreement. Not surprisingly, the ICC's view is that by submitting to ICC rules in an arbitration agreement entered into after the first of March of 2017 of this year, parties consent to the application of the rule for expedited proceedings, including the provision for appointment of a sole arbitrator for any dispute later arising that would fall under the ambit of such rules. For some insight as to how a national court might deal with this issue, I note that in the Singaporean case, AQZ versus ARA of 2015, an award rendered under the expedited CIAC rule was challenged, notably on the ground that the composition of the tribunal did not comply with the parties' arbitration agreement, which had expressly provided for a three-member tribunal instead of a sole arbitrator. The Singapore High Court rejected the challenge, holding that, and I quote, a commercially sensible approach to interpreting the parties' agreement would be to recognize that the CIAC president does have the discretion to appoint a sole arbitrator. Thus, the Singapore court took the view that by choosing the CIAC rules, the parties were bound to accept the court's power to make decisions, including with regard to the composition of the arbitral tribunal. No express assent is necessary for the expedited procedure to override an agreement requiring a three-member tribunal, the court held. It remains to be seen whether other national court will take similar views, but it is nonetheless a good indication of how courts might react. To conclude, I would say that the expedited rules are part of a wider movement to increase efficiency in arbitration. For example, the ICC is encouraging, as other institutions, arbitrators to conduct all normal proceedings more efficiently, more effectively, more expeditiously. The ICC court may, for instance, increase the arbitrator's fees for particular expeditious handling of a case, and is trying to deter arbitrators from taking too much time to render their award, potentially decreasing, and sometimes relatively significantly, the arbitrator's fees in case of undue delays. Most major arbitral institutions have also developed emergency arbitrator proceedings which permit a rapid constitution of a tribunal and rapid decision-making in case of urgency. The efficiency movements continue as some institutions such as SIAC and SCC have even introduced summary adjudication mechanisms in their rules. Whether the addition of such summary adjudication mechanisms is a move in the right direction and will be one of the next reform to the ICC rule will be interesting to see. It will be also interesting to see whether the SCIA, which only contemplates the expedited formation of the tribunal in case of exceptional emergency, will follow that trend and include detailed provision for expedited proceedings in its rule at its next reform. Thank you.
I promised you a smorgasbord of ideas and news and information, and all speakers can deliver that. I'm grateful of the organizers that understood that the major is not going to make its own bed, so it's better to either have it removed or do something else themselves. I'm aware of the time, and I'm not going to be asking questions to the speakers. I will reserve that right if there's not many volunteers from the audience. But I wanted to bring up, by way of summary, a series of questions. And I think there are a number of themes, overarching themes, that come up quite nicely in the four presentations we have here. Duncan addressed the question of not the lack of regulation, but perhaps the multiplicity of regulation and the various layers of regulation in terms of density, and perhaps hierarchy, and sort of try to reconcile what is there and prioritize what should be taken forward. Of course, what is very interesting in that debate about counsel ethics is it seems to take for granted that a certain type of behavior is ethical or a certain type of ethics should be followed. While we're not necessarily clear as to what is an ethical behavior, for example, in one of the few cases where we have in public sort of knowledge, sort of ACP in Slovenia, where we have a removal of a counsel in order to safeguard the integrity of the tribunal, technically, we have not seen any clearly unethical behavior by the counsel, but it was a preemptive action. And of course, we haven't had the removal of a counsel in BG and Argentina, where more or less one of the counsel did attack one of the arbitrators physically. Not verbal, I mean, that happens all the time, so that's not even qualifies for anything. So, what type of sort of behavior, in unethical behavior, is such as to warrant an action? That's a very big deal, and we don't seem to address that elephant in the room. And we take a very much sort of Anglo-American approach where ethics work very well, but everyone has seen behavior that perhaps we're not necessarily powerful, and that's a very big point of question. Richard addressed in his question, amongst other things, whether culture is actually the defining paradigm to do that, or whether it's effectively a matter of risk management. So, because Counsel doesn't want to give away certain arguments, including sort of due process argument. And I recall a few years back a debate in Vienna between two very eminent sort of counsel, where one sort of with a voting public, one was always making a motion to have a further sort of delay of the proceedings, and the other counsel was sort of trying to sort of defy that motion, which was almost invariably dilatory, but it was packaged in due process way, and 100% the audience voted in favor of delay. But of course, what happens here, the things that Richard has brought up is, for each counsel, there's a question of risk management, sort of what the best thing you can do for your client, and there's also a question of, which actually becomes much more prominent, it touches almost to something that Marco said, equality of arms. I mean, you can see cases where parties are not equally represented because either there's no representation at all, or the representation is not adequate, and how do you deal with that context? Is there a role to introduce a level playing field where it doesn't exist by the way of the teams? I mean, in England it's very common in the context not of the Premier League, but even in the Premier League, but perhaps in the Cup, where you can have a sort of a team that we said we would call it third or fourth league playing with the Premier League team, and every now and then there is a surprise. Almost, you always know that the Premier League team will do better than the other. And I'm not going to say anything about the French and Barcelona, because that's Paris Saint-Germain involved again here. In the third paper, sort of Marco addressed sort of three categories of third party. And of course, he played within jurisdictional reach and substantive reach. And one of the debates has moved perhaps from whether we can extend the scope of the agreement jurisdictionally as to whether substantive we can reach out in the contract. And the reality is that in almost all construction contracts, and a lot of contracts we have had some sort of funding, not third party funding, but funding in the performance of the contract, you have a third or a fourth or a fifth party in the case somehow. And the argument that has been brought up by my colleague Stavros Pribloukis is, if substantive law allows the extension, why would jurisdictional law not allow the extension? But the question there is, which is a thing that perhaps came up from Roland's piece as well, is what happens with party autonomy? And the attitude of the ICC is endorsed not just by the Singaporean case. In the first case of a challenge to an emergency arbitration decision under ICDR rules, the Court of California said, you agree to the rules, you agree to that. But the New York Convention 5.1d is still the sort of the Damocles sword, and eventually all institutions trying to be efficient at any cost means that perhaps we create sort of some challenge as to diminishing party autonomy quite substantially in some cases. So I will invite comments, questions, contributions from the audience. Keep your questions, contributions, comments brief, and once you do that, also introduce yourself and, if possible, to which member of the panel you want to address your question. So the floor is open.
I have a question for...
Introduce yourself first.
Okay, I'm Julian from the LSE. I have a question addressed to all members of the tribunal, but in particular to Marco de Souza, because he touched upon this very briefly. Just a clarification question first. Do you think it could be reasonable for an arbitrator to allow the recovery of the costs of third-party funding, so the uplift, etc.? And if so, what do you say to those people who are concerned about the losing respondent having to bear the claimant's costs, in particular, if the claimant's lawyers have a reduced incentive to control their costs, knowing that they will just be passed on?
Okay, let's collect a few more comments and we'll...
So I'm Jagdish, I'm from WilmerHale. I have a comment from Duncan's presentation, and also something that Professor Mistelis said. You talked about how there's a need for regulation and what actually the ethics are, but one of the areas where there may be a need for regulation is what actually happens when ethics are breached. That's just something that we've seen different courts and different tribunals react differently to. So for instance, you have the Croatia issue in the case against Slovenia, where there was chatter behind the scenes, and there you've seen, well, Croatia has just pulled up, but who actually takes the brunt of it? Is it the client, is it that individual counsel, is it the law firm? Maybe that's one particular area which does need regulation and urgently so.
My name is Odil, I'm from UCL. My question is to Mr. Roman. Since you were discussing about the 2015 Singaporean case, so had that case been with regard to the ICC under the ICC rules? And if the rules say that if the parties opt out of the expedited proceeding, so in the case of the Singaporean one, since the parties had expressly stated that they wanted the adjudication to be done by three arbitrators, wouldn't that be, in that context, a necessary implication that they have opted out from the expedited proceeding?
Wendy Miles from Good Boys Intended. Roland, an extension of that question. When the ICC applies its discretion to appoint three arbitrators or not in cases that are 2 million or under, is it, how do you think the ICC will manage the certainty, the transparency, and also reconciling the Singaporean case in applying that discretion? I understand that the parties have agreed to opt out if it's under 2 million, that's a clear line, but what about when the discretion is applied as permitted in the rules, for example, in the case of complexity?
We've recently seen the emergence of literature suggesting that both commercial and PTR panels should consider security for costs orders more seriously, given how active the third-party funding market has become. And open question to the panel, do you really see third-party orders becoming a regular part of the landscape?
And we might have time for one more. Yep.
Just a quick question to build on actually the first question and the last question regarding third-party funding. Is it really problematic third-party funding? Because for the conflict of interest, we have the obligation of the counsel on one side for the client, and the other side you can challenge the arbitrator if you have conflict of interest between third-party funding, third-party vendor and the arbitrator. And regarding the security forecast, we know that it's a common occurrence in international commercial arbitration sometimes. And regarding investment arbitration, we have the case RSM versus Santa Lucia, which made actually a lot of noise, but because we had a hit and run procedure from Santa Lucia. It was the first case of security forecast. But when we see regarding, when we see in investment arbitration, we see a lot of investors who are not paying costs, and nobody say anything about that, but when it's happened with a third-party funder, it makes a lot of noise. So I think regarding the not paying the cost in investment arbitration, it's a broader topic that only third-party funders.
And this even brings questions of asymmetry, quality of arms, access to justice as well. But so let's have then the panelists address the question in the order which they spoke. Actually, Duncan, you go first.
Certainly. Sort of first addressing the first question on third-party funding and whether a successful party should be able to recover their costs, I think the answer is yes, but within the discretion of the tribunal. And I think that's consistent with the recent decision of the English courts in SR and Norscott. In that case, the English courts rejected a Section 68 challenge against an award that gave the successful party the uplift that they had to pay to the funder. And the English courts held that the tribunal's discretion under the ICC rules to award other costs was sufficiently broad to encompass third-party funding, and therefore that was within the tribunal's jurisdiction, and there was no basis for a challenge. That doesn't mean that in every case the tribunal will award the successful party the costs of funding. The tribunal has a discretion, a broad discretion, but I think there will be cases when it is appropriate For example, take a case where a party has clearly and deliberately breached their contract because their counterparty, they believe, doesn't have the assets to pursue the claim. In those circumstances, it may be appropriate for the tribunal to say, yes, there was a breach of contract, deliberate breach of contract. The only way for the claimant to pursue that claim was to obtain third-party funding. Therefore, it's entirely legitimate for the successful claimant to recover their costs. But that is something within the inherent discretion of the tribunal. And I think, again, it's a matter of the tribunal exercising that discretion in a nuanced and sensitive way to reach a fair conclusion in the particular case. On the second case about regulation and the second question about regulation and the tribunals, whether there's a need for more regulation by the tribunal, I think, again, the Croatia and Slovenia case shows that tribunals already have the ability to regulate to ensure the integrity of the proceedings. In that case, the tribunal did exclude the barrister appointed at the last minute from the case. It held that there was no express right to do that under the ICSID rules, but it had an inherent ability to protect the integrity of the proceedings. And I think when we're talking about regulation, the important question is regulating for what purpose? And different regulatory bodies regulate for different purposes. The tribunal's priority should be ensuring the integrity of the proceedings. The tribunal's priority shouldn't necessarily be punishing counsel. That is perhaps the within the authority of national bar councils. And not something a tribunal should be interested in, but the tribunal has a broad discretion to take steps and put in place procedures that ensure the proceedings are fair, the proceedings are seen as being fair, there is a level playing field. And I think tribunals already have that power. It's not a matter of giving tribunals additional powers. It's a matter of using the discretion they already have to robustly reach the right result in particular cases.
Richard. Okay, the next question was, I think, well, moving on to the ICC point. I think it was a very complicated question about opting out of ICC proceedings by necessary implication. If you've chosen three arbitrators, does that mean that you have effectively displaced the rule that, or the discretion of the ICC to allow you to appoint just a sole arbitrator? I mean, that's a fairly complicated, frankly, legal question, but I would subscribe, but then I am someone who is very much in the sort of Singaporean mold to say that, look, if you have chosen these rules, and within those rules, there is a discretion afforded to the ICC, and you have not explicitly said this rule shall not apply. My own view is you're stuck with that discretion. As to the exercise of that discretion, and I think that was Wendy's point about, you know, how carefully are the ICC going to, how are they going to navigate this particular path? I think the answer is with in circumstances where, for example, a case may be particularly complex or difficult. I think transparency is important there in terms of the ICC court has to be, you know, very clear as to the circumstances in which and the criteria to which you'll have regard to in deciding to exercise that discretion. Because like one can perhaps foresee further challenging along the lines of that discretion has been improperly invoked.
I think one broader question here is to what extent decisions made by institutions are merely administrative or go beyond administrative. Because, I mean, obviously, part of the time it means once you accepted the rules as they are. But I remember a few years back, the reform of the Swiss rules,
which introduced this article 21.5, that they were actually bringing into under the Swiss rules set of claims and counterclaims which were covered by different contracts, by different dispute resolution clauses. And effectively, if the decision was there to consolidate, it was really a jurisdictional decision made by the institution for the tribunal, which is not challengeable, while the jurisdiction of the tribunal. I'm not saying that the ICC rules or the introduction of expedited proceedings have that jurisdictional side, but I think tribunals are being assessed on the due process this type of decisions, but institutions are not so far. So that's actually the big question.
Thanks. I'll limit myself to the questions that were raised about third-party funding, and just taking the first one from the back there around the recoverability of funding costs. I would echo what Duncan said about ultimately it falling to a matter of the exercise of the tribunal's discretion. And I think it's well established that tribunals enjoy a broad discretion to award costs. And so I think, you know, that risk that you mentioned of parties perhaps not having an incentive to control their costs is perhaps more apparent than real, in that there isn't really an incentive to do that anyway, because even if a party is successful and in principle is entitled to recover its cost, the tribunal will generally scrutinize those costs and decide for itself whether it considers them to have been reasonable. And so there's no real incentive to allow costs to spiral out of control, because that victory may then end up being a Pyrrhic one for the successful claimant. In terms of whether we see third-party funding becoming a regular fixture on the commercial arbitration landscape, of course it's difficult to know, again because of the private nature of the proceedings, just how prevalent third-party funding is, but certainly experience from the investment treaty side suggests that it is quite popular and that it is gaining in popularity. And I think the fact that the Hong Kong Law Reform Commission considered permitting third-party funding to be necessary to retain Hong Kong's competitive advantage is quite telling, and those Asian jurisdictions are playing catch-up in that respect.
But also perhaps you answer that the threshold that the number of third-party funders have of claims which are in excess of 120 million and sunk costs which are over a certain threshold as well, means that a lot of cases, although they could have been funded, they will not be fundable because they just need to divert their resources where they can divert them. So there's a lot of sort of the middle guy often sometimes cannot get to the support that you need to get. Roland,
you have one of yours. I'll comment very briefly maybe on the issue of the opting out and the discretion. On the opting out, I agree that theoretically the ICC could have adopted an approach where the mere fact of agreeing to a three-member tribunal would be considered as implicitly or impliedly opting out. This is not the approach that has been retained, and it's very clear from the note. I'm going to read you an extract of the note. Agreements to opt out should express in specific terms the party's intention, not subject themselves to the expedited procedure provision. And then the notes add, it is not sufficient to that effect that the parties have referred in the arbitration agreement to a three-member tribunal or have adopted time limits that depart from those provided in the expedited procedure. So it's very clear, and therefore, you know, from the ICC perspective at least, that would not be a valid opting out. Now, how a court would react, again, we have the Singapore example, but it remains to be seen how other jurisdictions will deal with that. As to when this question and the issue of the discretion, I would say first, it's to my knowledge, no decision has been taken yet by the court, and it remains to be seen how the court will react. I would minded to think that the court would take into account whether there are strong objections from one of the parties, the complexity of the case, whether there are unquantified claim in addition, whether a state or state entity is involved. Again, it's, I would say, relatively soft at this stage. The note itself, let me check the notes, at this, where the jurisdiction, where the seat of arbitration may be also a parameter in terms of enforcement, because the note states, the court may nevertheless appoint three arbitrators if appropriate in the circumstances. very vague, I agree with you, in the circumstances. In all cases, the court will invite the parties to comment in writing, so at least consult with the parties, and every effort will be made to ensure that the award is enforceable at law. So there is this concern, at least from the court perspective, that the court, that the award be enforceable at law, which is an obvious concern in such a scenario. What I would say is it's important to strike the right balance between, indeed, transparency, predictability, and to keep some flexibility.
Thank you. So, all it remains to me is to ask you to join me in thanking the panel in a traditional way.